excited and so thrilled about the word tonight. So if you were here last week, you heard me talk a little bit about just your role as a mom when you're a mother figure, whether you have biological children, whether you have spiritual children. I told you what some of the secrets were. And some of the secrets were to not take yourself so seriously, to enjoy the journey is one thing. And I told you to teach your children and point them to something that was more dependable and stronger than you or your husband, which would be their Father God, so that they have their own independent relationship with the Lord. And so to go along with that, one of the things that the Lord has really been working with me on almost for the last year is dealing with my mind and with my thoughts. And I started studying my mind and my thoughts even more so. And one of my favorite ministers, her name is Dr. Caroline Leaf. I love her stuff. And if you've never heard her, go on YouTube, look her up, take the time to look her up. And we'll watch a little snippet of some of her tonight. But you would be amazed at the power that your mind has and your thoughts have to determine who you are, where you're going, what your behaviors are going to be, what your choices are going to be, even your physical health, your physical being, and your mental being. I have not been so cognizant of mental being and mental awareness until a couple of years ago when my grandmother started showing early signs of dementia and towards the end of her life was just really disconnected and not coherent. And you have to understand, my grandmother, she lived to, I think she was 86 or 87. I have to do it by my age, but I don't feel like doing the math because it means I'd have to admit my age. I'm not going to do that right now. She was in her late 80s, and she worked for over 60 years. She entered the workforce when she was 17 years old. She lied and said she was 18 so she could get a job as a teacher, and she was an educator for 60 out of 80-some years. She didn't retire until she was in her 80s. And I remember telling her when she first retired, she's like, I can't wait to go home and I'm gonna sit on the front porch and I'm just gonna wave at people while they drive by and read my newspaper. She's like, I'm tired of y'all and all the, and taking care of y'all and running everything. And I remember the conversation so vividly because we were laughing and we were joking around. And I said, you can't do that. I said, that would be like taking a race car and parking it in somebody's driveway and not even starting it. And she's like, oh, look, girl, you don't know what you're talking about. And I watched just over 5 years her deteriorate so quickly. And I know that, you know, when my grandmother went home to be with the Lord, I know she up there running things, so she ain't mad at me that I'm telling all her stories because it's irrelevant when you in eternity. It's like, oh, look at that little girl. She's so cute. So it doesn't even matter. I can tell all her drama, all her shade, all her skeletons. She'd be like, oh, that's so cute. She don't care. But my point is that in that 5 years, she did not keep her mind alert and engaged. She loved the Lord. She loved the word. But there was something about the power of her thinking and her being engaged that would have kept her mental health better and would have kept her physical health better. So what I'm paying attention to, and this year I'll be 40-something. I'm closer to 50 than I'm comfortable with. And my mother will be 60-something. She'll appreciate that I didn't say the last number. And I've been challenging her, you got to make sure you're walking. You got to make sure that you're reading, that you're challenging your mind. Get new books. Get more books. Don't just read the same old books. And studying Dr. Caroline Leaf, and Dr. Caroline Leaf even makes a distinction between the mind and the brain, which I think is phenomenal. And she talks about your thoughts and what toxic thoughts look like in your brain, that they look like a briar patch. They look like thorns. And those thorns will crush out very healthy thoughts, that our healthy thoughts look like a healthy aloe vera, that they're really plush and they're luscious looking and they're really healthy looking. And so when you get toxic thoughts on top of healthy thoughts, you know, if I take a thorn and I prick an aloe vera, I'm gonna damage the aloe vera. But there's a way to get rid of toxic thoughts. You just have to focus your mind on the positive. And God is such a genius because in his word, he tells you what to think. It tells you to think on the good. It tells you to think on the praiseworthy. Because God knew that if we focused our mind on the negative, we would go down a path that would just lead us to depression and destruction and almost like a death while we're still alive. And so what I want to teach you tonight are just some things that the Lord has really led me to do to change that so that I can constantly be in a state of positive thinking. Amen? Amen. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you for the word tonight. God, I thank you that every mind is alert. God, I thank you that every heart is open. I thank you, Lord, that every ear is receptive and open to listening. Not just hearing, but listening. God, I thank you that the word falls on good ground, the ground of our heart in that soil, that the soil has been tilled up, that it's ready to receive the word. And God, that the word would bring light and life into our lives and to every life we touch. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, say within yourself. Put your hand over your heart. Say, I have to win,
I have to win.
The battle
of my mind.
Amen.
Amen.
You have to win. Like, you have to win. You'll hear me saying that over and over and over and over and over tonight, because you have to win. What I've learned is that the enemy loves to lurk in the shadows and the recesses in our soul, in our mind, our will, and our emotions, that he loves to bombard us with negative thoughts, that we love to rehearse our past. We love to rehearse who left and who did this and who didn't do this and who should have done that and what I should have said. And ooh, if I could see him right now, I got the right statement. I got the right comeback. You've been working on that comeback for 5 years. You may never see them again. If you just let go of the story, you won't ever need to have the great comeback. Or if something happens during the day, at night, you're just rehearsing it over in your mind, you got to at least tell three people. I don't know why we got to tell three people. You got to tell your boo, and then you got to tell at least two of your girlfriends. One that's going to agree with you, and one that maybe might correct you. She's just on the fence, depending on what kind of day she has, so you never know. She's the wild card. But there's one you're going to call who's going to always side with you, right or wrong. I've been one of us for a long time. I know how we act. And Stacy said, call her first. I used to call her first, and she'd be on my side, right or wrong. And then as the years progressed, the Lord was like, that is not what you need. I'm like, but that's what I want. I want somebody to just remind me that I'm right, even when I'm wrong. My grandmother used to say, when you wrong, you ain't got no reason to argue. And when you right, you ain't got no need to argue. Amen.
Amen.
So I don't really argue. I don't. If we're gonna enter into a communicative banter, I'm going to share with you my point of view. And if you don't want to receive it, cool. It's irrelevant. If we're gonna be in eternity together, we won't be mad about it there. And so why am I gonna let it affect me here? And especially if it's an unbeliever. I love the unbeliever because I love that God is sending people in their path to constantly water the seed that someone has planted. But I'm not gonna argue godly things with someone who is not a kingdom citizen, because I'm trying to argue principles and guidelines that they don't operate by, so I'm wasting my breath, and I'm not causing them to dig their heels up. They usually dig their heels in trying to prove me wrong. And I just say, you know what, when you know Jesus, you'll know it all.
Amen.
Or you'll know who knows it all. So you may not have every answer, but you do know the person who has every answer. And so you just don't argue about stuff. I don't argue with my children about everything. Why? Because I want to enjoy the journey. I want to love being a mom, which means I can't fight with them from the time they get up to the time they go to bed. Because then I'm not enjoying the journey. What am I pouring into them if I'm just the Wicked Witch of the West who is always telling them, clean your room, do the dishes, pick up this, you need to listen to me, you're not paying attention when I try to tell you what to do. All I'm doing is just setting up a great exit strategy for them. My son's room probably hasn't been cleaned since 2012. I don't know.
Shut the door.
I just shut the door. Praise God. The rest of the house is mine. I mean, the whole house is mine. But I feel like if this young man, and my son just turned 17 years old, he's not sleeping around. He's a virgin. I'm sorry, that's going to be on YouTube, but he is. He doesn't drink. He's not trying to smoke. He's not trying to hang out. He's not even trying to drive. He just got his permit because driving isn't really important, because he's like, I got you. He has a chauffeur, so he doesn't even care about driving. If he wants to hang out with his friends, he invites them over to our house. So he's not always trying to get out of the house. Why? Because I pick my battles, and I want him to think good about this part of his life. If he's only going to be in my house for one more year, it should be a fabulous year. And the dirty room is not a big deal. I can clean it in 13 months. Like, sometimes we get caught up thinking about the wrong thing and focusing on the wrong thing. If it's about kingdom stuff, if it's a life or death decision, if it's something that will impact someone in a godly way, then that's worth having the conversation. If it's something that's menial or petty or little, Lord, just show me the little stuff. so that I don't even have to worry about it. I don't major on the minors and the majors. If I let God handle them, then I am at much more peace just in my state of being and how I do life. But I have to win the battle of my mind, because what your mind will tell you is your mind will tell you that you have to win every argument. Your mind will tell you that you have to win every interaction. That if your kids don't jump to say, you know, yes, mom, or I'll do it right now, I'm going right now, then all of a sudden they're being disrespectful. Sometimes they're not being disrespectful. They're not paying attention. They got their headphones in, they're on their tablet, or they're on the video game. And so you got to get their attention before you can communicate. So before you get all angry and turned up, make sure that they're here first. Then you can decide whether or not it is an argument or a fight or a corrective action that you even want to enter into. And when I've had to correct my daughter, what I love about me and my daughter's relationship is I can tell her, this is a moment where you need to listen to me as your mom, because I see you headed down a road that's not going to do you well. So if we can just pray and have a family meeting and you can just receive it by the Holy Ghost, I will not bring it up again. And I give her that qualifier. Why? Because I want to have her 100% attention. I don't go in with, let me tell you what you need to do. She's 20. The fact that she even listens is the grace of God. Because she really doesn't have to. And so what I know in my life to be true is that if people won't listen to the voice of God, they probably are not going to listen to you. So it would do you well to respect people's free will to do the wrong thing. Because that's what God does. God accepts our free will to do the wrong thing. He loves us through it. He gives us grace through it. He gives us mercy through it. He gives us wisdom. He gives us counsel. We have the Holy Spirit. I don't know who could live their life and not listen to the Holy Spirit. I wouldn't recommend it, but if you want to do it, knock yourself out. But call me, because I'll pray for you when your stuff turns into a hot mess. Because it is if you don't listen to the Holy Spirit. But I'm not going to fight with you to listen to me. And so that's what we do in our own minds. And I know how the enemy works, because I pay attention to his strategies and his deceits. And what he loves to do is just bombard us with all of these attacks in our mind to where we have a low sense of self-esteem. We have a low sense of self-worth. We feel like other people don't like us. Other people aren't paying attention to us. You know, we're not smart enough. We're not beautiful enough. You're not the right color. You're not the right shape. You're not the right education level. You're not at the right socioeconomic level. Look, if God says that I'm the righteous, if God declares me to be the beloved, then if you don't like me, that's you, and that's cool. If I know that I'm operating by kingdom living principles, if I know I'm being kind, if I know I'm operating by love, what does love look like? Well, the Bible tells us what love looks like. That love is patient, that love is kind, that it isn't boastful, that it doesn't seek to have its own way. So I know if I'm operating by the guidelines of love and it's not being accepted, then that's okay. Then I don't have to fight about it. But for me to allow the enemy to exacerbate me with somebody doesn't like you, or somebody is talking about you, or somebody is this, or somebody is this, there's always going to be a somebody. But you have to win the battle of your mind where God tells you you're enough and that you matter. How many of us spend half of our lives dealing with the lie that we are not enough? We're bombarded with that lie. That lie starts when you're a little girl. That lie starts when you're in kindergarten and somebody bullies you who don't like you. That lie continues through elementary school when somebody tells you you're not good at math or you're not good at science or girls aren't as good at sports as boys are. Shoot, if you've seen my daughter when she was in high school used to do one-arm pull-ups just because she could. And she'd do it in front of a group of boys and then she'd jump down. Yeah. And I'd be like, you know they're not going to ask you out after you do it. You know, I'm just saying. And she's like, I don't care. She's like, I do what I want. And I love that spiritedness about her because that's how she felt about it. And so when we get bombarded with those thoughts, you know, I've said this to you before, life is not always about learning new things. Life is a lot of times about unlearning old things. Yes. Getting rid of those old thought patterns, getting rid of those old habits, getting rid of toxic thinking. We sometimes have patterns of toxic thinking. And it starts with that cornerstone foundational belief that we are not enough. Well, where are you not enough? And did God say you're not enough? Because I would doubt that that's what your daddy said about you. Now, he may tell you that there are some decisions that you can make and some choices that you can make that would display his image to a greater degree and better than you are right now, but it doesn't mean you're not enough. It just means you're continuing to be refined. You're continuing to be perfected. You're continuing to growing and developing to be more in the image of your father. Amen? It doesn't mean that you're not enough. Turn to your sister girl and say, you are enough.
You are enough.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Like I felt the anointing. And I'll tell you why I feel the anointing is because some of you have never heard that.
Yeah.
Oh, I feel the anointing so strongly right now because some of you have never heard that in your life. Turn to your sister again or your other sister and tell her, you are enough. You're enough. You are fabulous. You are wonderfully made. You know, the Bible tells you that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. You know, I had to accept that as my truth because there was a season in my life when my truth was greater than the word of God in my life, but my truth was a lie. Because my truth was that I didn't matter and that I wasn't enough. Because I didn't meet my father until I was a young girl. I didn't meet my dad, I don't think, until I was maybe 9 or 10 years old. And so when you don't meet him until then, but you hear about all these siblings who are hanging around with him and doing stuff with him, I remember just cycling through that I wasn't enough. And then my mother experienced domestic violence when I was 5 years old. You guys have heard me share it before, so you know my story. And when she went through that, she decided to leave me with my grandmother's aunt and uncle, and that's who raised me. So because I didn't grow up with my mom, now I'm really feeling that I'm not enough. Then my mom had my sister. My sister and I are 5 years apart. And my mom kept my sister and she didn't come get me. And I'm not throwing shade at my mom. My mom made the best decisions that she could with the information that she had at the time. And she was setting me up for a great life because she was not at that time capable of taking care of both of us. So I am not throwing shade at her. I love her. She is my very best and most dear friend. We have put all of our baggage aside. We have unpacked the bags and we are healthy. So don't think I'm throwing shade at my mom. I love my mom. I'm just giving you information as to why I was the way I was. And so a lot of times you will go through things where you have felt dismissed or you have felt discharged or you have felt put aside. And then the enemy will come and will add to that all that little yak in your ear. Like, you see, didn't nobody want you. You see, you're not smart enough to get that award. You see, you weren't good enough to do that sport. You see, you're just a throwaway. You're just disposable. I talk to women all the time who feel disposable. I know what it's like to feel disposable. I know when that's your truth. And I'm telling you, the greatest battle you will ever fight is the battle in your mind. Because you have to turn the corner to where you're like, God, I'm going to choose to believe you, even though it doesn't make sense to me, even though it's brand new for me. I'm not even comfortable with saying I'm enough, but I'm going to say it, and at some point, maybe I'll believe it. And I know you'll hear people say, fake it until you make it. It's not faking it until you're making it. I'm speaking it because it's coming to pass. So I'm calling a thing until I see the thing come to pass. Amen?
Amen.
And that's what helps you move past or move through these tragedies and these hardships is you got to shut off your source of information if your source of information is not the Word of God.
That's right.
You can no longer be defined by your peers, your parents, your past, none of that. Some of you had amazing life stories, but you still don't feel worthy. Sometimes my daughter struggles with feeling worthy. And you want to know why? She says, well, Mom, you are such an overachiever. And I remember thinking the first time she said that, I was like, whose house did you grow up in? Like, were we in the same house? What do you mean I'm an overachiever? She's like, well, you have your doctorate degree, and you've been in ministry for almost 20 years, and you hear from the Holy Ghost like that? And she's like, it's a lot to live up to. I'm like, daughter, let me help you. I'm like, come in close. Let me help you. When I was 20 years old, I was acting crazy. Like, acting crazy. When I was 20 years old, if I can even remember, because God is just, He's so gracious that I asked him to just allow me to forget a lot of stuff I did when I was younger, and he's so good, he let me forget it. So I have to like dredge it up to remember it. And then I laugh about it. I'm like, oh my gosh, I really did do that. Like, ugh, that's not even kind of cute. At 20 years old, let me think. I flunked out of college. I think I was either working or about to start working in a gentleman's club.
Yeah. Go on.
I'm just being honest. I'm just telling, I was, you know, if you looked at me sideways and I even thought you were about to disrespect me, it was on and popping. Like, I'm little, but I would come out of a set of heels and start swinging in a heartbeat. Because I grew up with this fear that if I allowed someone to control me, that they would hurt me. Because I watched my mom go through domestic violence. So my interpretation of that was I had to be the strongest, the toughest, the loudest, the most dominant, the most aggressive, the most hardcore. Like, I carried a bat everywhere I went. A stickball bat. It's not even a pretty baseball bat. It's a stickball bat. In fact, it's at my house right now in the garage. I made it, I think, in 1987. I bought it and I spray painted it, and I really cannot tell you what it said. I can't. Maybe I'll text it to you later. Okay, I can't say the whole thing. It said, be killer. But it was written out. And I had spray painted like black and gold because I was from Louisiana, so that was like New Orleans Saints colors. And here I am walking around with a bat. I did some crazy stuff. So thank God for Jesus. Like, y'all don't even know that version of me. Praise God. But I shared that with my daughter so that I could tell my daughter, don't be overwhelmed by the enemy telling you that I'm an overachiever and use that as the lie that's going to get you off track. So that's the only reason I shared all that with you. Is you can't let the enemy come at you with a lie. You know, that's false. So she's like, you're an overachiever. I became an overachiever like at 30. So that means there was 30 years that I just kind of squandered away. So I had to tell my daughter, remind her, you are so far ahead of me and where I was. I celebrate you, that you listen to the Holy Spirit, that you endeavor to do what he tells you to do. You got to win this battle of your mind, because if you don't get this now, trust me, this will be you walking in the desert until you finally decide I'm going into the promises of God. Does that make sense? I really feel like in a lot of ways, the battlefield of your mind is your last desert place.
Yes.
Because when you can come out of Egypt, out of your old thinking, then you go into this season of battling with your thoughts. Well, I trust God, I don't trust God. I believe God, I don't believe God. God is here today, he might not be here tomorrow. And I get it, because you have a lot of things coming at you to convince you that he's really not there for you. Those are all lies. Because he is always there. He is always communicating with you. He's always talking to you. I talk to people sometimes who will tell me, well, I don't hear God. Well, do you have a Bible? Because if you have a Bible, you can hear God. Because there's a lot of stuff he put in there for you. So don't think that, you know, because you feel like you can't hear him in this moment by the Holy Ghost, that you can't find him. Open his word. You can find him still. And it's hard for him to talk when there's a lot of noise in the background of your mind. When you're so busy in doubt and unbelief, it's hard for the word to get through. So you have to choose to trust him just no matter what. You got to dig your heels in deep. And the reason I feel like this word came tonight is because after our event last week and what I've just been praying over the women who are coming here to this ministry is just for us to grow up. That we encourage each other, but we're not dependent upon each other. I don't need to call you when I'm going through something, because I can get on my knees and I can talk to my Father. I can get in the word and I can get an answer. I can get a scripture that I can stand on. It's cool if I can call you, but I'm calling you to come into agreement with me and not to have the answer to my challenge. God is the answer to my challenge, no matter what my challenge is. So I just need a sister girl who's going to be like, okay, what are we praying about? Not someone who's helping you meditate on it and rehearse it and nurse it and then grow it up to a big, fat, ugly, stinking baby. You want a girlfriend who wears big girl panties. You want one that's like, okay, Where are we going? What's the topic? Let's look in the power of confession from Dr. Marie. Let's look on Bible Gateway. Let's get a scripture. What are we doing? What are we standing on? You want a sister girl who's willing to go to battle with you and not sit on the sidelines and watch you fight on your own. Because the battle has already been won, but you got to go through some of these things because we have to get over ourselves. We have to get past all those voices behind us that are trying to define us and tell us who we are. Amen?
Amen.
You know the scripture, so as a man thinks in his heart,
so is he.
So I have to decide that my heart is filled with thoughts of goodness and mercy and grace and love. And I only want the things of God, that God is not out to get me. He's not a deadbeat dad and he's not an abusive father. So he doesn't abuse me to teach me lessons. He doesn't set me up for failure so that he can get a lesson out of it. He will use my failure to get a lesson, to get a testimony out of it, but maybe I caused it. Or maybe someone else caused it, but he didn't cause it. And sometimes he just gets the flack for stuff that he didn't have anything to do with. But because he works it all out for our good, we're like, oh, God just did that to help me grow up. No, he didn't. No, he didn't. God did not use molestation. He did not use abuse, domestic violence. He did not use two marriages and two divorces to bring me to a place where I could become a pastor. That's a lie. I became a pastor in spite of those things. I became a pastor because his grace and his mercy that endured and that covered me to bring me to a place where I could finally say yes and stop being my own worst enemy and fighting with a father who loved me. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yes.
Like it just wouldn't, it's just crazy that I would beat my kids up to make them better. But because that may be a household that we grew up in, that's how we think God is. See, we attribute human behavior to God, and God is God. You have to be able to separate the two. Watch over your heart with all diligence, because from it flows the springs of life. In the Children's Bible, I love this. This is in the International Children's Bible. It says, be very careful about what you think, because your thoughts run your life. Your thoughts run your life. Think about where you are today in this very moment. This moment is a result of your past thoughts and a decision that you made. So there may be some things going on in your world that you need to fix, but you got to start with your thought life. But you made a great choice today by coming to Bible study because you're like, I don't know what's going down, but I know I'm going to get me whatever God has for me tonight.
That's right.
Amen?
That's
right. And for some of you, this teaching will be a game changer. This teaching will put you on a different trajectory for your future. Because you're going to be cognizant and aware of what you're thinking. You're not just going to let thoughts come by. I can't even tell you how many thoughts go through your mind in the course of a day that you either accept or reject. Does that make sense? You either accept them or you... Even as I'm talking to you. So check this out. I love the Holy Ghost. You are so smart. Oh my goodness. So even as I'm talking to you, there are some of you who are battling accepting what I'm saying because it doesn't line up with what your current belief system is telling you.
Amen.
And then there are some of you who are on the fence. That's like, it sounds good. I don't know if it applies to me. I might try it. I'm not sure. And then there are others of you that are like, yes. Oh my gosh. I'm so glad you are teaching this. I'm getting lots of notes because this has got to change before I even leave out the building. And it doesn't matter where you are. I'm just saying that's what happens when people are talking to you on a daily basis. You are making all types of decisions about if you're going to receive what they're saying as your truth and allow it to become your truth. I'm telling you that the greatest battlefield is in your mind. And some of y'all are like, no, it ain't.
That's true.
And I know I'm preaching the truth because I feel the Holy Ghost. And it's cool if you don't believe it's true. Life will teach you and the Holy Spirit will lead you to a place where you'd be like, I remember when Pastor Dionne said that. Look, let some of my life lessons be a blessing to you and help you avoid some speed bumps in your journey.
Amen.
A mind governed by the flesh is death, but a mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. Colossians 3:2 in the Amplified says, set your mind and keep focused habitually on the things above, heavenly things, not on the things that are on the earth, which only have temporal value. And then I asked the Father, Psalm 25, 4 through 5, make me know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day. Lord, teach me your truth. Lord, let your truth become my truth. Lord, I let go of my truth. Because my truth may be riddled with my feelings. It may be riddled with my past or with lies. I want your truth to become my truth. And I surrender and open myself to that. And I leave no place covered up from you. Right? God, I love the correction of the Holy Ghost. God, show me where I'm off. And I don't go searching around for wrong and for sin. I don't go fishing. I don't do that. I just let the Holy Spirit reveal it to me, because if he reveals it to me, then he knows I'm ready to get rid of it. Dealing with low self-esteem, I had to be ready to accept who I am. And I wasn't ready, because there was a time when I would have never told you that my mother is a domestic violence survivor. I would have never told you I worked in a gentleman's club. Why? Because I'm like, they're not going to like me. They're going to judge me. They're like, ugh. Maybe they won't receive what I have to say. Look, if you don't receive what I have to say, that's cool. It doesn't obligate me any less to say it, because I work for Jesus. Does that make sense? And that's how you want to be in your life. Why am I not intimidated by you judging me? Because you don't run heaven or hell. So it's cool. You ain't got nowhere to put me, no way. Judge me all you want to. What you gonna do? Say something on social media? Okay. It's whatever. Soon as I got a YouTube channel, I know somebody gonna say something on social media. It's cool. God's truth has to become my truth. You have to be defined by the word of God and not let other people subject you to their definition of who they think you are or who they think you should be. I've had people tell me, this is a true story, and then we're going to finish up. I had somebody tell me, I'm not even going to tell you the whole story. I had somebody tell me that before I would even endeavor to either be on YouTube or to get a website or blah, 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 blah. Like, you know, most of the people who are really accepted or who are really famous and preaching and teaching the word, they're a little bit smaller than you are. No, you can't make that up. That's a true story. That's a true story. I need to lose weight. And I had a complex, like for real. I had a complex, because you know, I'm a Southern girl. And in the South, you know, we bill them a little, we bill them sturdy. We bill sturdy girls in the South. You know, we don't bill, and bless the little women, bless you. But that has never been my journey. I have never been you, I will never be you. There's like two pictures of me that my daughter put on Instagram from like 100 years ago when I was a size 4. I look ill. If you can see that video, maybe I'll post it tomorrow. I'll tell her to loan me her video so I can post it. I look sick. You would see that picture and be like, who are you? Because that's just not how we build them. And so a lot of years, I was like, you know, if when I got my website, I'm like, I have to put different pictures of it, and they have to be taken at a certain angle. And then as you can see, you know, I'm very blessed by the Lord. And when you walk in the blessings like I do, it's a waste of energy to be self-conscious and not have a good sense of self. But I was tormented that maybe I couldn't do it. And then I'm like, Lord, what's coming out of my mouth is so much more important if it's the gospel and it's the word of God than what I look like. So then I was like, God, you got to partner with me just to pick my outfits. Because I can't even do that, because I get into too much, you know, thinking about it. And a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So I can't be unstable. So sometimes I go in my closet, I'm like, okay, Holy Spirit. Before you talk about what's wrong with your life, before you talk about what's wrong with yourself, just open your mouth and tell the Holy Spirit to fill it. Bless your children. Bless your husband. Bless your house. You think your house is raggedy? Bless that house, because you're not homeless.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
Amen. Amen. You're not driving a new car? Bless that car. It runs.
That's right.
My car, I told you, it's a 2007 Toyota 4Runner, 214,000 miles, rolling like a boss chick. I hit the gas. She like, where we going? I'm not tripping. God didn't tell me to buy a new car. So when God tells me, that's when I will go get something else. But I don't complain. Like, I see other people in something new. I'm like, well, bless you. I celebrate you for your new whip. In fact, I lay hands on it because you got yours. Mine is coming. I'm not throwing salt. But I'm going to ride mine because mine don't have a payment.
Yes.
So, hallelujah. Yes. Psalm 19:14 says, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. You know, just before that, David says something really interesting. He says, who can understand my errors? And he says, cleanse me, God, from my secret faults. And that's what I ask God to do. Because y'all don't know what my secret faults are, but God does. So I'm like, God, cleanse me of my secret faults. Anything that would interfere with your ability to work through me and to work in me, remove it. Help me have grace for other people. Because at some point, somebody had to have grace for me. The shocker of the night will be that the same blood that was shed for you was shed for the person who hurt you, was shed for the person who abused you, was shed for the person who left you, was shed for the person who tried to kill you, who was shed for the person who abandoned you, who rejected you. It's the same blood. The blood doesn't pick and choose. And I am so grateful for the blood of Jesus, because when that blood ran, it paid the price for everything. And when I look back over my life and I see what God has forgiven me of and what God has washed from my slate, that my slate even gets to be white, then I decided there will be no debt in my heart for any man or woman. So it's easy for me to walk in forgiveness, even when they don't deserve it, because I look at my life and I'm like, God, when I didn't deserve forgiveness, you gave it to me. Amen. Think about this, and then we'll go. When Jesus was on the cross, and Jesus said, forgive them, for they know not what they do. For years, we have been taught, and correctly taught, that it was against the offenders who hung him. But what if it was for all of us?
Oh, yeah.
Forgive them, for they know not what they do. When I was 20, acting ignorant and acting crazy and living outside of the will of God, that's when the blood paid the price for even that. And it said, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I didn't know that working in a gentleman's club was opening myself up to so much demonic attack and demonic influence and ungodliness and perversion and hurt and mistreatment and abuse. I didn't know that. But my father knew that. And so when he shed his blood, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When I was mistreating other Christians or other believers and I'm starting fights all the time, his blood was poured and was shed and said, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Where in your life has the blood paid a perfect price and you diminish the value of that payment that was made when you have thoughts that are misaligned to what price he paid? So you have to win this battle. Your future is contingent upon it. The generations behind you are depending upon you to get this right. To break the chains of adultery, to break the chains of abuse, to break the chains of depression, to break the chains of abortions, whatever needs to be broken in your family. When you take territory, you not only take it for yourself, but the word declares you take it for your children and your children's children.
Amen.
So the sooner you can get it right, you can teach them how to get it right, and then they won't go through what we've gone through. And that's all we want. I don't know a mother in here who doesn't want their children to outdo them.
That's right.
And I told my children that the greatest gift you can give to me is a great life.
That's right.
Where you don't struggle, where you don't have lack, where you don't have tears being shed, where you don't go through unnecessary heartache and heartbreak because you learn how to listen to the voice of God.
Amen.
You have to win.
Yes.
Amen. James 2:7, it says, so you see, faith by itself is not enough unless it produces good deeds. It's dead and useless. Now, someone may argue that some people have faith, others have deeds. But I say, How can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? I will show you my faith by my good deeds. We will know they are Christians by their love. We will know they are Christians by their love, by their love. You remember that? We sung that in children's church. So that's how people know that we know the Father, is how we treat them, how we treat ourselves, how we treat each other. Learn to love yourself. And then loving other people becomes super easy because you love the Father, you love what He created in you, and then it's easy to open yourself to love others the same way. Amen?
Amen.
Say, I have to win.
I have to win.
The battle of my mind.
The battle of my mind.
If you got something out of that, give the Lord a hand. Amen. For those of you watching on YouTube, if you're ever in the Mesa area, please come down here. We will love you up real good. We'll give you a hug, a high five, a handshake, whatever you want.
Yes,
but all your girlfriends are waiting for you. We'd love to meet you. And if you can't come down to Mesa and join us, just keep watching. We promise that it will always be a godly word. We'll always encourage you. We'll always support you, and we are always praying for you. God bless you. Bye.